So I'm going to get right into it. Be efficient. Thank you for being here. This very special day, not only for our church, but special day for Kylie, because he is taking a huge step in his walk with God, and he's willing to say that he is not ashamed of Christ, that he wants to let everyone know that he is a follower and a believer in Christ. So I want to talk a little bit about what is baptism, and you know, who should be baptized, and when should someone be baptized, things like that. But I want to start with some of the last words of our Savior Jesus Christ, and then I'm going to go to a passage in Acts chapter 8 about a man who got baptized, and kind of he asked this question: What's keeping me, or what do I need to do in order to be baptized? And that is a good question. And a man asked that sincere question, and Acts 8 is where I'm going to turn in a moment. But I want to remind us as a church, and remind all of us, some of the very last words that Jesus spoke to his disciples, to his followers, was this. He said, "Go into all the world and preach the gospel." The gospel means the good news. The good news is that Jesus Christ came. He lived a perfect life. He lived a life without sin. And he became a perfect substitute. He personally died upon a cross. An innocent man was buried. Think about this. He was buried. Listen now. He was buried, but he arose again. That's why we're here today. We serve a risen Savior. Amen. And he's in the world today. Woo! Amen. We serve a risen Savior. He's alive. He is risen. That is why we're here. That's the good news. I tell you, my brothers and sisters in Christ, Paul said it like this: if Jesus had died and he had not risen, then we would be men and women most miserable. Listen, we'd be miserable. But there's good news. He is alive.
Amen.
He is risen. And we serve a risen Savior. We sang about him all morning. And he is alive. He is risen. He did not stay in the tomb. He resurrected. That is the good news. And Jesus said to his disciples, ask after he resurrected. And as he was standing there, before he ascends into the heavens, he says to them, go into all the world. Preach the gospel. And then he says this, baptizing them. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost. Baptizing them. And then he says, teach them to follow me. Teach them to be obedient to me. That is the great commission. To preach the gospel, the good news. Amen. To baptize. And after a person's baptized, then to continue to follow Christ the rest of your life. Amen. But this is that big first step. And you're taking that step today. And I'm proud of you.
Amen.
Amen.
Our church is proud of you. We're excited. We all come to celebrate this huge decision that you have made. In Acts chapter 8, there's a story about a man. And I won't read all of it, but I want to get to an interesting question he does ask. Because there's the command of Jesus. Jesus says, follow me now. He says, go out into all the world, preach the gospel. Well, one of the followers later, his name was Philip. Philip believed upon Christ. Philip then went into all the world. He went to a place called Samaria. He goes to Samaria and begins teaching and preaching. Samaritans were people who were outcasts, but he took the gospel to them because the gospel is for everyone.
Amen.
Amen. The good news is for everyone. Amen. No matter what color a person's skin is, no matter how rich, no matter how poor, no matter what they have to offer or don't offer, the good news is for everyone.
Amen.
And so he went to a place called Samaria, and it was a place where there were outcasts. And the whole city, God is working, God is moving. And while Philip is there, one day, the Spirit says to Philip, Philip, go out into the desert. Go out to Tucson. Well, it wasn't quite Tucson. It was called a place called Gaza. It was a desert place. It was the desert. He said, go out into the desert, and I'll tell you what I want you to do. I'm paraphrasing. So he goes. So think about this. He's being sensitive to the Lord. Why is God sending me to the desert? I'm in the city where all the people are. There's no one out in the desert. But he goes. He goes out into the desert. The Bible says that while he's out there, he sees this chariot. The Bible tells us there's a very wealthy man, a man of authority. He's from Africa. He's from Ethiopia. A very wealthy man. In fact, he is, the Bible says he's an Ethiopian, and he's the treasurer for the queen, Candace the queen. So he is the treasurer, very wealthy man. And the Bible says that he traveled all the way to Jerusalem because he wanted to worship. Here's a man who's seeking God. He's seeking a walk with God, a relationship with God. So he goes in that day, what is considered even to this day, to be one of the most holiest of cities. Truly, God is in Jerusalem. Truly, God is there. So he travels from Africa, from Ethiopia, and he makes his trip, and the Bible says he goes to Jerusalem. And he goes to Jerusalem to worship. And while he's there, he picks up the scroll. He has the Bible. He has the book of Isaiah. He's on his way home. And on his way home, he's riding in his chariot. Very wealthy man. And as he's riding his chariot, guess who's there along the way? Philip. Just by chance, Philip happens to be standing there. As he looks over, he sees this chariot going by. And the Spirit says to Philip, go over to that chariot. And so he goes. The Bible says that he runs over to the chariot. Now, can you picture this scene? They're out in the middle of nowhere. Here's this very wealthy man in this chariot with lots of money. He's leaving Jerusalem. He's got the Bible in his hand. And the Bible says he's reading Isaiah 53, verses 7 and 8, that he was led as a lamb to the slaughter, speaking of Christ. And while he's reading it, picture this now. Picture this crazy man. Here's Philip. He's running. He's running. Hey, hey, you up there. Do you understand what you're reading? And the guy looks down and he says, no, I have no clue. Who is this man talking about? And Philip says, well, you want me to explain it to you? And the guy says, yeah. And Philip's like, can you stop the chariot, please? It's in there, I'm telling you. He stops the chariot. So Philip's probably like me right now, out of breath. He's completely out of breath. He says, can I come up there and show you? He says, yes. And the Bible says that Philip goes up into the chariot. We're in Acts chapter 8. After he just read Isaiah 53, 7 and 8. And he says to him, do you understand? He says, no. Who is this man? Who is he speaking about? And the Bible says this. In verse 35, then Philip opened his mouth. And he began in that same scripture in the book of Isaiah. And he preached unto him and he told him about Jesus. He told him about Jesus, the Messiah, the good news. And it doesn't stop there. And as they went on their way, they came to a certain water. So they're still traveling. He's riding the chariot with them. And the eunuch said, see, over here, there's water. What is keeping me from being baptized? Now listen to these words. And Philip said, if you believe with all of your heart, you may. And he answered and said, listen to what this man said. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And he commanded the chariot to stand still. And it says that they both went down into the water, both Philip and the eunuch, and he was baptized. And they were come up out of the water. The Spirit caught away Philip, and the eunuch saw him no more. Notice this. And speaking of this Ethiopian man, it says that the Ethiopian man went away rejoicing. Why? He was rejoicing because he had received the good news of the gospel and because he took a step of faith and obedience, and following the Lord in obedience. You know, it's interesting. You say, well, why did this man ask about baptism? It's most likely because he was in Jerusalem. And while he was there, and he's on this spiritual journey, and he's seeking God, he sees other people being baptized. And when he saw other people being baptized, he didn't understand. He didn't understand, well, why are they being baptized? And what's necessary to be baptized? And these were things that he was thinking of. These are things that he was pondering. Well, they're being baptized. Well, why? I've never been baptized. And boy, I wonder what this is all about. You see, aren't you thankful that we have a God in heaven who is pursuing us and seeking us and loves us and cares about us? Because God knew that this man went seeking God, seeking a walk with God, a relationship with God, and he was truly, genuinely searching and seeking, and God knew that. And he left Jerusalem still missing a fellowship with God. But God said, you know what? I have someone I'm going to send to help you. Isn't that awesome? And so this man, as he's leaving, probably think about this, don't miss this, as this man is leaving Jerusalem with more questions than when he got there. More questions, wondering, empty, religious, but no relationship. You know, there's a lot of people that are very religious. They have religion, but no relationship with Christ. This man was a religious man. Follow me now. He traveled a great distance to go to the most holy city to worship. And when he left, he's still searching. He's still empty. And God knew it. And God sent Philip. He sent this man who was sensitive to the Lord. And you and I, brothers and sisters, we must be sensitive to the moving of the Spirit in our lives. That God will bring people across our paths. God will bring people into our lives. And if we're sensitive and we listen to the Spirit like Philip did, that God can use us to be ministers. God can use us to help point other people to the good news. Amen?
Amen.
And that's what Philip did. Philip was just sensitive to the Lord. And God said, go out to the middle of the desert. And Philip said, the middle of the desert? There's nothing out in the middle of the desert. And when he got out there and he was obedient, here comes the chariot. Here comes a man who's seeking God. Now, you want to know something? Do not miss this. Church history tells us that much of Africa was evangelized as a result of this man taking the gospel with him back to Africa. Much of Africa was evangelized through this man because one man named Philip was sensitive to God, sensitive to his Spirit. You and I, brothers and sisters, need to be sensitive to God's moving and working in our lives and be obedient. Philip was obedient. This man heard the good news. He says, now that I know and now that I... He says, what will keep me from being baptized? That's a good question. And Philip says, you must believe with all of your heart. And do not miss this. This Ethiopian man says this, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. He's saying, I believe that he is the Messiah, that he is God in the flesh, that he is my hope. He is the way, the truth, and the life. Are you with me?
Amen.
It's through faith. And he trusted Christ. He believed upon him. And listen, he says, all right, stop. Pull the chariot over. Pull it over. And let's get baptized. Now, let me throw this out here very quickly. They're out in the middle of the desert. God provided the witness. God provided even a place for this man to be baptized. Probably wasn't fancy. Come on now. I have had the privilege to baptize 16 to 20 people at different times in the Jordan River. Do you know Jesus was baptized in the Jordan River? Do you know what they called the Jordan River most of the time? The Muddy Jordan. It's dirty. It's nothing fancy about the Jordan River. The Jordan River, I'm going to tell you this, is freezing cold. Freezing cold. Like ice cold. Because it comes from... It's the melt-off from way up in the mountains. That's what feeds it. So it's basically all the snow and the melt-off from the mountains that runs down and comes down through the Jordan River. The Jordan River is, first of all, freezing cold. The last time I was there, I baptized 16 people. So follow me now. I have to be the first guy in. I'm the first guy in and the last guy out. And when people started getting in, they said, Pastor Joe, they said, how can you stand it? I said, I'm numb by now. I'm telling you, God is my witness. I was almost hypothermic. I was like, by the time I got done with number 16, I was like, you need to send in search and rescue to get me out of here. But I'll never forget this. You guys want to hear a story? I'll never forget this. So we're getting ready to baptize, and we start walking down in, and I look, and all of a sudden, I'm telling you, I have 16 witnesses that will bear witness to this. there's these catfish sitting there looking right at me. I walk down into the water, and I'm not talking about little catfish. There's catfish longer than my arm. These huge catfish, and not one, not two, not three, not four, not five. I'm talking 50, 60, 70 catfish everywhere. And I'm thinking, they're going to eat me alive. And I remember walking down in there, and I thought, why are there so many catfish? I'm like, oh, yeah, all these Jewish dietary laws probably. You know, I don't know. So no one ever fishes for them. But I remember, I was like, you've got to be kidding. And I went to get in the water, and I said, guys, can we baptize over there? So we tried to find a spot where there weren't, you know, hundreds of catfish longer than my arm, literally like swarming you, because I think people feed them or something, or they feed on people. I'm not sure which. But they were everywhere. It was muddy. It was freezing cold. Fish, catfish, all up in your face, all up in your business. You know what I'm talking about? You know what I thought about? The humility of Jesus Christ. The humility of Christ, God's Son, creator of all universe, walked out into the muddy, dirty, gross, catfish-infested Jordan and got baptized. He was identifying with the ministry and the gospel of that time of John the Baptist. And then, you study through history, you study through the scriptures, that many, many believers follow Christ in baptism. It is not about where you get baptized. It's not about the fact that it's a portable hot tub. I'm going to tell you this. This is a whole lot better and cleaner than the Jordan River. And warmer, let me tell you that. It's going to be a little chilly, all right? But it's a whole lot warmer than the Jordan, trust me. You know, I have some of my good friends, guys who serve our military, veterans. One of my good friends back home, talked to him, and he was in, I believe, in Afghanistan, and he said he accepted Christ. He said there was a chaplain, and he said, man, bullets flying and bombs going off, and your life's, I mean, every day you're wondering, am I going to live or die? And if I die, where am I going to go? Where will I spend eternity? And the chaplain shared with him the good news, he accepted Christ. You know what they did? They didn't have anywhere to baptize. You know what they did? They took out their little shovels, and they dug a small little hole. They put some trash bags down, and they used bottled water, and they just filled that thing up, and then the guy would lay down in a hole filled with bottled water and trash bags to keep the water in, and then they would all gather around, the soldiers and the chaplain would say, you know, have you accepted Christ? Have you believed upon him? And that you're saying you're not ashamed and you follow me? He said, yes. He said, I got baptized in a hole in the ground lined with trash bags. Can I just tell you something? It doesn't matter where, all of that, because listen, it just matters if you're willing to follow Christ in obedience. So what is baptism? Baptism is symbolic. It's a picture of the death, the burial, resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's why we baptize. The word baptize means to immerse, to dip, to dunk. So it's a picture of dying, burying, resurrecting. That someday, as believers in Christ, we die, we're buried. But we don't stay there. We go to be with the Lord. Amen. Beyond that, it's a picture of a new walk in our fellowship with God. That when we die, we're dying to our old self. That old self is buried. And in Christ, we're a new person. Amen. We're a new creation in Jesus Christ. Oh, how awesome that is. That when we accept Christ, that old man is gone and we become a new person. Yes, he's working on us every day. Amen. We're all a work in progress, but that old person is gone and now we're a new person in Jesus Christ. That's what baptism is. Let me finish with this. Baptism is identifying with Jesus Christ. Baptism is saying this, I am not ashamed of him. I want everyone to know of the decision that I've made in my heart. You see, salvation, a walk with God, it is a hard decision that we all must make. Every one of us, it's a step of faith and trust and believing in Christ. So we believe in our heart, we trust him. But then baptism is kind of the outward show of that. It's saying, I identify with Christ. I am not ashamed of Christ. And so I always illustrate it like this as we're getting in and get ready to baptize in just a few moments. I always illustrate it like this. The day I got married, my wife and I stood at an altar. We stood side by side looking at one another. We exchanged vows. We gave one another our hearts. But you know, there was something else that we exchanged that day. You know what it was? Wedding ring. Now, if I take this ring off, if I can get it off, if I take this ring off, if I pull this off, does it mean I'm not married?
No.
I'm still married, right? What is this ring? This ring lets the whole world know that I'm married, that I belong to my wife. My wife belongs to me. So the day we got married, let's say I couldn't afford wedding rings or we didn't have wedding rings, and we still exchange vows. Does that mean I'm not married? No. But when I put on that ring, I'm saying to everyone, I belong to my wife. My wife, as she wears the ring, she says, I belong to him. When we get baptized, when you get baptized today, you're saying, I belong to Jesus and Jesus belongs to me. I am his and he is mine. Woo! That's awesome.
Amen.
You're saying this, I'm not ashamed of Jesus. I want everyone, I want my family to know, my church family. I want everyone to know that I belong to Jesus. What would you think of me? What would you think of me? What kind of guy would I be? Let's be honest now. If someone said to me, so you're married? Yeah, I'm married. Who's your wife, Courtney? But when I go to the gym, I take my ring off because I don't want anyone to know. What would you think of that kind of guy? Come on now.
We'd be looking for a new pastor.
Yeah. We'd be looking for a new pastor. You'd say, that's just wrong. What kind of follower of Christ would we be if we were secret Christians, right? Closet Christians that said, you know what, I believe in Christ, I'm going to accept him, but I don't want anyone to know I'm ashamed. You'd say, that's terrible. That's why when we get baptized, it is identifying. It's saying, look, I am not ashamed of Christ. I want the whole world to know that I belong to him and he belongs to me. Baptism is awesome. It is a huge step in your walk with God. And so one must accept Christ like this man, believe upon Christ. If you've accepted Christ, you've believed upon Christ, really the next step then, in your walk with God, is to be baptized. So when you are old enough and you can come to that understanding and you can personally make that decision for yourself to believe upon Christ, like Kylan has done, and then when they say, you know what, I want to get baptized, then we rejoice because we realize they want the whole world to know. Kylan wants the world to know that he's a follower of Jesus Christ. All God's people said, amen. So this is an exciting time. Are you ready to have our baptism today? Kylan, upon your public profession of faith in Jesus Christ, we now baptize you, our little brother, named the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his dad, John. Praise and give me so walk in the newness of life. We are a new creation, new creature in Christ as we follow him. And all God's people said this morning,
amen. Amen.